Well, I've got two lovers and I ain't ashamed. Two lovers and I love them both the same.
The Golden State Warriors fell apart in the fourth quarter of Game 1, allowing the Celtics to not only light them up from behind the arc at key moments, but also failing to score for huge stretches that doomed them to a loss. And looking at the lineup data, the starters for the Warriors destroyed their counterparts in about 14 of these minutes, but then turned around and looked like mere mortals for huge swatches of the game. This schizophrenic nature makes it hard to figure out what's going to happen in Game 2. But let's compare and contrast the differences across this game to get a sense of what adjustments the Warriors need to do.
Let me tell you about my first lover. He's sweet and kind, and he's mine, all mine. I really, really love him. Oh, 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 oh.
This is the offense that completely lit up the Celtics for 19 three-pointers and made them look downright unprepared in the first quarter, as the Warriors must have felt they were going to have an easy win.
Let me tell you about my other lover. Well, you know he treats me bad.
As the Celtics changed their lineups and ramped up the pressure, Golden State's offense wilted, allowing the Celtics to storm right back into the game and even take a lead heading into halftime. In the fourth, the Warriors' offense completely deserted them for two big stretches. This pick and roll for Poole is just misdirection, as the real action is the pin down for Clay. Notice that Williams drops his coverage here and there's no one to pick up the shooter. But Clay's feet are set too wide. He begins to drift to his left. Notice the right leg lift up in order to keep him vertical, and there's no power left to make the shot. Compare this to earlier in the game when they catch a mismatch with Horford on Clay. They run the same action as Porter pins down. Williams does that same drop, and Thompson doesn't have to dribble it. Just step hop into a beautiful and open swish. They run a two-man game out top with Poole and Iguodala, eventually catching Williams dropped again, but watch how Pritchard uses his footwork to slalom step with his left foot around the screen, then swivel his hips and run to get back in the play. Was there a foul here? Maybe, but the Warriors come up empty. In the third, they defend this with Horford dropping, but Smart is assuming it would be a switch, and Poole gets a wide-open shot that he's not going to miss very often. Here's the floppy set they run with Poole and Clay sprinting out to either side, and they suppose they've got a mismatch with Pritchard guarding Iguodala down low, but a turned-around 12-footer is just a big mistake by Iggy, and they come up empty. To overcome Iguodala's lack of scoring ability, he works much better playing in the corner and working as a cutter. This was a much better design play, as they're flare screening for Clay while they're running the pick and roll. All defenders are occupied, and despite the switch, Pritchard is caught behind Draymond, White has to rotate up, and there's no one left to stop the slam. Through most of the fourth, the Warriors relied mostly on spread pick and roll instead of their normal clever movement and action that mixes Curry off and on ball. Instead of hunting out Pritchard, they try and pick on Horford, and it's not a bad idea, as he snakes the dribble into a short two-footed floater that he shoots short. Compare that to another spread pick and roll where Curry is much more aggressive getting near the basket, this time hitting White with a beautiful up and under for the finger roll, a much higher percentage shot than the tougher floater he tried before. I decided I needed a former NBA player and current CBS analyst to help me break down this next clip, so Shelvin Mack came to the rescue. Shelvin, thanks for coming in to the show and really helping us break this stuff down. I'm fascinated to hear what your take is. And we have a play in the fourth quarter I wanted to go through with you and see what your thoughts were as the Warriors are bringing the ball down. What do you see here? How does this play shape up? What's the point of this? And what are they trying to get?
So what I see at this is, Boston did a great job of picking up full court. You know, you set the intensity for the possession. You know, he's turning Steph Curry a few times, eating up some of the clock, and crosses over at 16. Then Boston Celtics did a great job of switching majority of the game. So Golden State's running a great play. You got the back screen at the bottom. Stephen Clay's a switch. And then Tatum is switching it again with White. And what makes this play so good for Boston defensively is a lot of people back up off Draymond Green. You know, give him opportunity to see the floor. As you see on the switch, Looney slips and he's wide open. But Al does a great job of having ball pressure with what a lot of guys typically don't do against Draymond Green.
You know, what is the main focus of this play, though, the way this is set up? Where are they really trying to go? Obviously, it's a nice thing they had to slip for Looney. But what's the main focus and who are they really trying to get a shot for?
No, they're really trying to get Clay coming off a pin down. with Looney. But Looney saw that they switched beforehand, you know, being a great player he is, and he tried to get the switch again and cut to the basket. It's just a turnover by Draymond.
So this was one of those unfortunate things where if you're a coach at the Warriors bench, you're like, great, it worked perfectly. And then, you know, better defense sometimes wins out. The Warriors want to attack Pritchard with Curry as they clear out the left wing to let him go to work. However, Pritchard does a great job forcing him baseline and close enough to the corner where White can offer some resistance as well. The rest of this possession completely falls apart as they had no other options after the step isolation, and as the shot clock wound down, Wiggins can't gain an advantage, so screws Draymond by leaving him with the check by passing it to him with no time left for the jack up a contested three. Compare that to this ISO for Steph when he hits Jaylen Brown with a devastating behind-the-back dribble, but then gets lucky Horford wasn't willing to block this back to his family in the stands. But the point remains, Curry should be attacking into the middle to break down the defense. This time, the Warriors stack the left side of the floor and run an empty side pick and roll with Curry and Looney. Again, they're picking on Horford instead of more lucrative targets, and on the snake dribble, Curry does get an open look, but side jumping to the right for a right-handed shooter is one of the toughest shots in all of basketball. Meanwhile, when using the screen to the left and catching Tice dropping laughably too far, it's a lot easier for a righty to get proper alignment as Steph knocks down this open look. Let's bring Sheldon back in to discuss this possession for the Warriors. A little bit later in the fourth, with the Warriors struggling to get any kind of buckets, and they're already down 8 after an onslaught by the Celtics, which we covered yesterday in the other video. What are they trying to run here? What do you think the focus is to try and obviously get a great shot to try and stem the tide?
Yeah, as you can see, Boston's on an 11-0 run the last 2 minutes. They're trying to get Clay a touch and a wide-open side of the play. Poole does a great job of clearing out. You're getting Tatum out. As we said before, Boston is switching all the screens. So Steph and Clay get the switch, and then Draymond's trying to get the hammer to give Clay a wide open shot. But Marcus Smart, being a great defender he is, he can see everything happening. So as you see it's happening, he sees Clay's open. He's playing two guys, and he closes out. As we talked earlier before, the slip is there, but the ball pressure is hard to make that pass. You see the switch. Draymond's cutting to the basket. He's open. It's just a hard pass to make when Jaylen Brown's ball pressure on Steph Curry. But with the great play that Coach Kerr drew up, when he gets the ball, he still has that whole side to go. It's just clear out. So you can rip it, catch and shoot, or whatever. Just beat your man off the dribble. And he's going, Al comes over. He's able to get a jump down pass to Draymond Green. And no, he's able to get a foul. It's just a great possession overall by both teams. You know, unfortunately, sometimes it ends that way. As Al did a great job coming up from the weak side, seeing everything happen, understanding who he's guarding, Wiggins. He can help out a little bit more. Contested shot and just ended in a foul. But great play by Coach Kerr drawing up out of the timeout.
And I thought this was interesting because, again, there's a slip there that they kind of missed. Like you said, it's a hard pass. You know, you can see Curry's throwing a lefty pass. Listen, you played in the league and you made those kind of passes. How hard is that lefty under pressure if you wanted to try and get it to Draymond? Is that even possible?
It's very difficult being 6'4 and think Jaylen Green's 6'6, 6'7. It's a hard pass to make on with his wingspan. And then everyone can kind of see it happening. No, that's the reason why Boston's the second best defensive team in the NBA. They make it, they put it tough on you, cause a lot of disruption, get a lot of deflections, and force you into trying to bait those passes, and they do a great job of reacting.
Well, Sheldon, thank you so much for coming on and breaking this down. That was really great insight. Love the background, by the way. That's a really great message you have out there. Is that something that you like to practice yourself?
Yeah, no, every day I tweet. Every morning, think positive. You know, just have a great perspective on the day. Looking forward to things happening. That's been working out for me, you know, throughout my 32 years of living.
Well, I can't wait to see you more doing this more on CBS and anywhere else. And are you still? How's the jump shot working these days?
I'm still good. I'm still getting out there once or twice a week, making sure I'm staying in shape. No, I can't get that bad body like a lot of athletes do. So staying working out, staying in shape.
All right. Well, promise you'll come back again later in the finals. We'll do some more.
Oh, yeah, I'll definitely have to come back. I'm actually going to go up to game 4, you know, get to see it personally and live. So I'd love to get back on after that game.
Great. We'll see you then. They only ran that play once, and it was hard to find Clay even ball screening. But here, he does so for Poole, and they get a double staggered pin down for Iguodala, who can hit a catch-and-shoot corner three from time to time, especially if he hops into the shot like he does here. With the game just about over anyway, they run a pin down for Curry, who sucks in the help from Horford one pass away, opening up the good look for Wiggins, but he leaves it long. Unlike the low point for the Celtics defense in the first half, when a pin away for Curry is supposed to be a switch, instead, White stays with his man as well, leaving Steph to lick his thumb and check the wind he's so wide open. And to show you how bad it got for them, another chance for Steph to attack the Defensive Player of the Year gets him a layup. But Draymond is caught holding Tatum to prevent the help, and the Warriors are now left to ponder which offense they'll get on any given possession. If I were Coach Kerr, I'd cut Andre's minutes down, find a way to squeeze another 2 minutes more for Curry, and hope that the mix of intuition and alchemy yields one more lineup that matches up well with the Celtics, avoiding this particular one altogether, and hoping that Jordan Poole has gotten over his first game jitters and can get back to being a serious threat.
'Cause you're a split personality.